Friends, I consider it a privilege to sit here and introduce the speaker of this evening, Dr. Ajay Mathur. First, I'll just read through the usual things. Ajay Mathur is Director General of TERI, the Energy and Resources Institute, and a member of the Prime Minister's Council on Climate Change. He was Director General of the Bureau of Energy Efficiency in the Government of India from 2006 till February 2016, and responsible for bringing energy efficiency into our homes, offices, and factories through initiatives such as the Star Labeling Program for Appliances, the Energy Conservation Building Code, and the Perform, Achieve, and Trade Program for energy-intensive industries. Dr. Mathur was earlier with TERI from 1986 to 2000, and then headed the climate change team of World Bank in Washington, D.C. He was president of Suzlon Energy Limited, also headed the interim secretariat of the Green Climate Fund. He has been a key India climate change negotiator and was also the Indian spokesperson at the 2015 climate negotiations at Paris. He is a global leader on technological approaches to address climate change. Recently, he joined the global group of industrial, financial, and think tank leaders to co-chair an energy transitions commission, which will suggest ways for companies and countries to move towards climate-friendly energy futures. One could go on and take all the time that has been allocated to Ajay Mathur for this talk in the evening, but I do feel tempted to add a couple of lines to it. That is, we have known each other for a long time, and this afternoon, when Professor Ahuja and I talked about our proposal to advance Indian Standard Time for half an hour, after we had made the presentation, there was not, and this was a TERI conference, and some people said, will the sun go by what you ask the sun to do? What do you answer to such a question? But the man who was the quickest in finding out that this is something which is worth looking at was Ajay Mathur. After the presentation, he called aside and said, Debbie, let's go for a cup of coffee. So he sat down. He said, I think we'll discuss this in detail. But to cut a long story short, he not only funded NIAS after the usual process, and he constituted a committee of 30 experts to go through this and see how good it was, how correct it was, and so on. And whenever this had to be presented at various places, secretaries and so on, Ajay did it all. And here publicly, I express our gratitude to Ajay Mathur for supporting us in this program. And having said this, I'd request you to go and make your presentation. Thank you.
Professor Baldev Raj, Professor Ahuja, Professor Sengupta, friends of many, many years, and new friends as well. It's always a pleasure to come to NIAS. It's a place where I feel recharged, where new ideas come, where old ideas are put to the test of the rigor of the thought and logic of people who I meet here. I'm looking forward to that this evening as well. Professor Sengupta spoke of the fact that I was part of the Indian delegation which was negotiating the climate change agreement in Paris. And that is what I would like to share. I would like to share my experiences there with you. And in doing so, what I'd like to do is to focus first on what was our thinking, what was our status as we went in, what happened in Paris, and end up with, therefore, what are the challenges to India as we move ahead. I have only three slides, which are more in the way of remembering, for me to remember what are the main things that I would like to discuss with you. Now, as far as climate change is concerned, it's an issue that affects each one of us, and for very many different reasons, and sometimes for each one of us for multiple reasons. And it's very easy to see why. The impacts of climate change could imply that on the one hand, our hydrological cycles would change. And the most frightening thing about that is that the future that is predicted is one in which, at least in the medium term, we would have both more floods and more droughts. And this places a huge challenge. Okay, so then what do we do with greater volatility? Where will we store the water? Surface storage in this country is a huge problem because of the large density of population. And that implies that the amount, that the livelihoods of farmers and the amount of food you and I get would be affected. The flip side of it is that if we want to address climate change, the greatest challenge is to move towards energy systems which can lead to a lower amount of carbon dioxide emissions in the atmosphere. But we have a huge challenge. In this country, the average amount of energy consumed by a person, not supplied, consumed by a person, is something of the order of about half a ton of oil equivalent per person per year. This is in a unit tons of oil equivalent, so electricity, coal, oil, all have been merged into it. You could obviously use any other metric, but this is a metric which is commonly used across the world, half a ton of oil equivalent per person per year. Is this very high? Is this very low? Well, the way I look at it is there is no country in the world that has been able to have a high quality of life. And I'm using a human development index of 0.9 as a surrogate for a high quality of life. So there is no country in the world which has been able to reach a human development index of 0.9 or more without using at least 2.5 tons of oil equivalent per person per year. Now compare the two. We use half a ton. And in order to have a good lifestyle with a sustainable livelihood, the best, the lowest that a country has been able to do is 2.5 tons. So we are talking of increasing our energy consumption by 5 times. Now, the good thing about this, of course, is that as countries have developed, the amount of energy that it needs to reach this high-quality lifestyle has been diminishing. Why? Because as we have invested in infrastructure, countries which industrialized later were able to put in more efficient, less energy-consuming infrastructure. So the 2.5 is Japan and Korea. 7 is most of the European countries. 10 plus is where the US and Canada are. There is no reason why in, say, 10 to 15 years, I think we should be able to reach a high quality of life at possibly 2 or 1.5 or 1.8 tons of oil equivalent per capita. But that is still 3 times, or more than 3 times, 3.5 times where we are today. So the first point that I'd like to leave you with is that energy use in this country will increase, has to increase for a better quality of life. Now comes the challenge. Our paradigm of development, and indeed the paradigm of development of every country in the world till today, is based on energy use and carbon-based energy use. So we use coal largely for electricity generation and petroleum products for transportation. That's the nature of our economy. There's a third part, which is that people who can't afford or don't have access to commercial fuels, coal-based fuels, electricity, or petroleum-based fuels, petrol, diesel, etc., kerosene, their lifestyles are based on collected firewood. So that's the third large part. Now, collected firewood is good because it, as far as today, the total amount of wood or biomass that is used is less than the total amount of biomass that grows every year. So currently, the balance is that since the extractions are less, it is still marginally carbon positive. We add about 1 billion tons of carbon. Carbon dioxide is captured in the biomass in spite of what is taken out. So this is where we are. Now, on the other hand, there is the entire challenge of reducing our carbon emissions. If we are going to reduce our carbon emissions, how will we do that? To a large extent, there are three ways you can do it. The first is that we use less energy to do the same amount of work. So, you know, you change all the bulbs to LED bulbs. You get the same amount of light, but with half as much energy as if you were using CFLs or tube lights. The second is the energy that you do need comes more and more from renewable sources of energy where the net carbon emissions are zero. And the third is that we increase the forest and tree cover, so more and more of CO2 is sequestered, is captured in the biomass, and hopefully these three things together could possibly lead to a future where we absorb more carbon dioxide than we emit. So there is a possibility of a carbon neutral future based on aggressively pushing on these three fronts. Now, how do we achieve this? What are the challenges? Well, very simply put, the challenge is one of costs. If you look at energy efficiency, and I gave the example of LED bulbs, that certainly works, but an LED bulb costs more than a normal bulb or a CFL. So each one of us is challenged when we go to the market to buy it. And therefore, many people would prefer to buy a cheaper, more higher energy consuming product than a lower energy consuming product. We need to address this issue, and that's why the star labeling program came in, through which you and I, when we stand in front of an air conditioner, we know that this is a 5-star air conditioner. It may cost more, but it will use less electricity. It will pay for itself in the long run. Or actually, in the case of labeling, actually in the short run. For LEDs, we created the Domestic Energy Efficient Lighting Program, the DELP program, which in many parts of the country, including in Karnataka, provides a model in which, through bulk procurement, LED bulb is made available, but more importantly, you can pay it in increments of 10 rupees per month in your electricity bill. So a medium is provided so that you and I are don't have a price shock when we go to buy a LED bulb. Short point, first cost is higher. It is a challenge. For those kinds of more efficient products where the recovery from the lower energy use, because lower energy use means savings, so there is some cost recovery, where that recovery occurs in 3 to 5 years, those can be pushed. But if you have options which require more than 3 to 5 years, what we have found is that consumers typically do not purchase those appliances. Case in point is inverter air conditioners. All of us know about it, all of us like it, but a few of us do buy it, but its share in the market is still less than 1%. Possibly as we go into the future and prices reduce, more of us will buy them. So this is the second thing that I'd like to leave you with, that energy efficient products are a way of reducing the amount of carbon dioxide, reducing the demand for energy. However, higher first costs do present a challenge, though the lower energy costs during its lifetime present an opportunity to make business models through which these can be sold. The next way to address the climate problem is through renewables. Now, we have actually seen a revolution in the last few years. Again, electricity from renewables costs a lot. 10 years ago, wind energy used to cost 3 rupees a kilowatt hour, when electricity from coal at the power station was somewhere in the vicinity of 1 rupee 20 paisa to 1 rupee 50 paisa per kilowatt hour. However, today, wind electricity still costs 3 rupees to 3 rupees 50 paisa a kilowatt hour. But coal-based electricity now costs in excess of 2 rupees per kilowatt hour for a new plant that is established today. So relative to coal, wind has become cheaper. And, you know, obviously if you look at it in real prices rather than normative prices, wind has become cheaper. Because, you know, prices have increased, the price of wind energy has remained constant. We see an even more dramatic shift when we look at solar. Only 4 years ago, in 2012, we were buying solar electricity at 18 to 25 rupees per kilowatt hour. Now, with the bulk procurement being done and done in a competitive manner, the last order that was issued was 4 rupees 32 paisa a kilowatt hour. Amazing drop. However, even at 4 rupees 32 paisa, state distribution companies, electricity distribution companies don't want to buy it. Because you can get coal-based electricity at 2 rupees 20 paisa, half the price. So there is a challenge. In spite of this large drop, there is still a challenge that the price is still too high. Now, the way regulators have dealt with it is that they say, okay, there is some percentage, 1%, 2% of electricity that we'll get from renewables. It costs more. But when you pool the price across all the sources, it means a, say, 10 paisa increase for each kilowatt hour of electricity that is sold. The regulators think that is an acceptable price that you and I are willing to pay. And generally we have been. As volumes have increased, prices have decreased, and then the regulator has increased the percentage of renewables to be bought, and on and on and on. So that is how prices have decreased and percentages of renewables that have come in have increased. In other words, we went to Paris knowing that there are mechanisms through which prices can decline and technology evolution can occur. This is very different from, say, 10 years ago, when we were completely beholden both for technology and for money to the developed countries. where we saw that we would not be able to do anything to address climate change beyond our narrow programs in case globally technology and finance was not available. So the understanding as we went was that climate change is an issue. It will an issue that will impact us. It is important for us to address this issue. Addressing this issue will imply technological changes, both on energy supply and energy demand. And that technology evolution and the price evolution of these technologies is a key to how this, how quickly a transformation can occur. Now we went to Paris. We went to Paris against a background that there have been many, many, many years, more than a decade and a half, since there has been any movement on a global regime to address climate change. The last time that an agreement occurred was in 1997, when the countries of the world agreed to the Kyoto Protocol, which set targets for the developed countries on the amount of emission reductions they had to achieve by 2012. So this was discussed. It was largely a black box discussion, and out of it emerged the US and Europe would reduce their emissions by 7%, somebody by 8%, most of Russia and the former economies have transitioned by 0% by 2012. So only developed countries and fixed targets for them. This led to two kinds of problems. First was a political problem of acceptance. Most importantly, even at the time of the Kyoto Protocol itself, when the discussions were occurring, the US political system, the Senate, saying it's not acceptable to us that developing countries, particularly the large developing countries and the named China and India, are not part of this. Because they looked at it as a measure that reduced the competitiveness of production. But the second problem that occurred was as we came nearer to 2012. And as countries found that they could not meet their targets, they stepped out of the protocol. So Canada stepped out, Australia stepped out, Japan stepped out, US in any case had never joined. So essentially, it was the European Union which was left as the only bloc which stayed in the Kyoto Protocol and met its targets. This obviously created a huge degree of lack of trust and confidence. The developed countries who had the targets came in with a lack of confidence that they could meet targets. So targets became a dirty word. And many other countries, including India and other developing countries, we did not have the confidence that the developed countries would deliver on what they promised. Now, this is the goals that they promised. They'd also promised technology, they'd also promised finance. As I said, when this was negotiated, we had very little idea of what it takes to have technology and finance at a price that can make a huge difference in our countries. So we did not see much technology and finance flowing to help the transition in developing countries. So a huge atmosphere of lack of trust and confidence had been created. Nowhere was this more evident than in the climate change negotiations that happened in Copenhagen in 2009. When the talks essentially broke down because nobody was willing to trust the other parties. Paris, therefore, was the next opportunity. It was fairly clear to everybody we did not want a Copenhagen again. It was also fairly clear that the kind of architecture that Kyoto had, which was top-down targets is something that would not fly, that countries would not move in that direction. So we went into Paris, and there was this huge amount of negotiations that had happened before Paris, leading to the kinds of decisions that were there. But one of the prime new pieces of architecture was that each country would voluntarily say what it would achieve, what would be its contributions to addressing the climate change problem. These were called intended nationally determined contributions, INDCs. So going into Paris, most of the world, you know, accounting for 80-some percent of the emissions, greenhouse gas emissions in the world, had submitted their INDCs. Note that this is what countries said that they will do on their own. We also pledged. And the goal was that you meet these targets by 2030. And at that point of time, prior to Paris, there was thinking that beyond that, people will again take on targets. So the atmosphere going in was that since you have put, you've already put in your INDCs, you have promised it. Since you have promised it yourself, the chances are high that you will deliver on it. Now, when all the INDCs were added up, and their impact was calculated, it was fairly clear, not fairly clear, it was absolutely clear that they would lead to a temperature increase of at least 2.7 degrees above the pre-industrial level. Now, why is this important? Because the scientific work of the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and the decisions that the climate change negotiations themselves have taken over the years have set 2 degrees as a kind of Lakshman Rekha. We don't want the global temperature to be more than 2 degrees, because there is a very strong scientific basis and a broad political consensus that if the temperature increases more than 2 degrees centigrade, it will lead to irreversible harm, because then we will be stuck in possibly a kind of a runaway greenhouse effect, which we would then not be able to address. So the goal is that by the year 2100, climate is stabilized and the increase that is there is 2 degrees centigrade. So when you add up all the INDCs, they don't bring you below 2 degrees. They take you to 2.7 plus. So when we went to Paris, the issue was, how do we address this issue of the fact that countries have made pledges, but the pledges do not add up to what we want? And again, there was a large amount of discussion that this, there should be some top-down approach. But many of us, India certainly, pointed to the fact that you do any top-down approach, and if people don't find it doable, they walk out. So we wanted to preserve this broad understanding that was emerging, that the goals that countries take will be those that they are willing to do themselves. But we had to square the circle in as much as the goals should be such that they can still keep us below the 2-degree target. So what happened at Paris was, first, there was a very broad political agreement that we not only want to keep the global temperature rise to less than 2 degrees above the pre-industrial levels, but much less, go towards 1.5. So it was not 2 plus, but 2 minus. And that there was a broad political agreement for this is remarkable. It was pushed by the Marshall Islands. And they were able to convince a whole group of people, including India, And I must confess that when we went in, we thought that two itself is difficult, and we came out agreeing to something much less than two, 1.5. The second thing, which in a sense had been already agreed, was that all countries have to take action. In Kyoto Protocol, it was a few developed countries. Now there was a broad agreement that everybody has to take action, but the action that India will take will be both qualitatively and quantitatively different from, say, what the United States would do. So the United States in its INDC had said that by 2030, its emissions would be, if I'm not wrong, 27% less than they were in 2005, absolute emissions. We, on the other hand, said that in 2030, the carbon intensity of our emissions, that means total greenhouse gas emissions divided by the GDP, in 2030 would be 33 to 35% less in 2030 compared to what it was in 2005. The point was, we will grow. As we grow and people have better livelihoods, we will use more energy. That energy will be, some of that energy will be carbon based, so there will be greenhouse gas emissions, but compared to our growth, those emissions will keep reducing. So the greenhouse gas divided by GDP ratio would keep declining. So qualitatively it was different. There is no absolute reduction that we have promised in our INDC, but we have said that we will become, both in terms of energy efficiency and renewables and carbon sequestration, more efficient than we are. Now we came to the issue of, okay, what do we do about the fact that the INDCs together are unable to take us to below 2 degrees centigrade? And there the resolution finally was that we will ratchet up our pledges periodically. So we have now got a set of pledges. As we come to 2020, we will have a relook at them. We may resubmit whatever we have submitted now, which is our goal for 2030, but there is a chance for countries to resubmit it. Then in 2030, a new phase will start, and countries would have by that time submitted what they will do in the, what they will set to achieve in the next 5 years. And then the next 5 years, and then the next 5 years. So there would be a rolling set of time periods. And for each time period, countries would pledge goals which are more ambitious than the goals that they pledged the last time. This progressive ambition would take us towards the 2 degree goal. So in the middle of each period, there would be a review where it would be seen where, what is the science saying? What is it that the actions of the countries are doing? And these two things together would provide a global goal. And then countries would make a pledge with that global goal in mind. It may still not add up to the global goal, but the global goal is there. And it becomes a kind of an aspirational target. But the third part that it was agreed there, which I think was truly first of a kind, was the reporting mechanism. So that each country has a transparent mechanism to report on what it is doing and the impact that it is having. Details of this have yet to be worked out. Since this Paris Agreement comes into force from 2020, we have 5 years or 4 years to work those out. But the point is that countries would continuously put in the public domain what they are doing. Why is this important? Because once it's in the public domain, and if you and I are concerned about climate change, we can ask our government, the Germans can ask their government, the Japanese can ask their government, why are they not on track to meet their own pledges? You promised it, why are you not doing it? In my view, what it does, it converts an international problem into a national political debate. You know, you think of it. Canada didn't meet its goals and walked out of the Kyoto Protocol. So the Prime Minister of India was upset. The Chancellor of Germany was upset. Did it matter to the Canadian Prime Minister? It doesn't. But if Canadian citizens are upset, then the Canadian Prime Minister is worried. And the same thing will apply to India. When you and I and our press around us take the government to task for not meeting its goals, that, in my view, is the best way of pushing the government towards action that it has promised itself to do. Now, all of this leads to national actions, whether on the goal setting, whether on the transparency mechanisms, whether on the mechanisms that would be put into place that lead to a larger national debate. But how will these things be done? The issue of technology and finance hasn't disappeared. Yes, we have come into the Paris negotiations with a far better understanding of the fact that technology development does occur, that the costs of technology deployment are declining. But yes, there are still positive costs. We are still looking at technologies which sometimes are not around. So the Paris Agreement also has sections on finance and technology. But as in previous years, they are weak. I personally don't see anything coming out of the finance section. There was a commitment made by the developed countries in Copenhagen that there would be $100 billion of climate finance that would flow to developing countries by 2020. $100 billion a year. There is some amount of debate on how do you count that, but certainly it is so nowhere near that amount. And now in Paris, there is an agreement that there will be even more money with 100 billion as a base, which we will think of in 2018 so that it can come into force after 2020. I don't see the $100 billion coming. I don't see whatever is agreed in 2018 coming either. This has challenges for us, and I'll discuss those in the next section when I move to challenges for India. Then there is the part on technology. Now on technology, a few years ago, we forced the creation of a technology mechanism, which could be a means through which technological advice and essentially technological advice could be provided to developing countries. Again, the performance of that has been poor to middling. So there is again language on technological cooperation amongst countries, but by itself it's not particularly strong. But what to me brought some degree of optimism is the International Solar Alliance that was launched at Paris, essentially a brainchild of our Prime Minister, and the Mission Innovation that was launched at Paris by the French President, the US President, and our Prime Minister. Because these two do have the potential, and how much of that potential is realized, I don't know. But they do have the potential to forge a degree of, at the very least, conversation amongst countries on technology, and possibly, I hope, an agreement on the kinds of technologies that are important to different groups of countries. specifications so that industry gets a very clear signal of what it is that the demand will be. And second, if they are able to coordinate the timing at which each country will come in with demand, so, you know, industry then knows this year the global demand will be for 100 gigawatts of solar of this specification. That helps in, one, making that available, and two, for competitive pricing to occur. Because when 20 countries or 30 countries or 100 countries procure the same kind of thing, competitive pressures would bring the price down. Just as in the LED case, competitive pressures brought down the price of a 7-watt LED from 310 rupees in January 2014 to 63 rupees in January 2016. Semiconductors, I think we can, through these kinds of scale and competitive pressures, help bring the cost down again. So these are positive signs. I believe that we have to work to make sure that you get the potential out of what that happens. So in a nutshell, this is what happened at Paris. 2 degrees minus goal. A pledge, accomplish that pledge, and then pledge more kind of mechanism. A transparent monitoring, transparent reporting and monitoring mechanism, and a mechanism, and these consortia to help technology take off. I believe this together forms a very different kind of a framework to what has existed in the past. In doing so, I must comment on 2 things. One, this does have the chance of breaking that lack of trust and confidence that occurred in the past. Because if I am able to achieve what I promised, then I have the confidence that I can deliver more. You know, think of your own programs. When you are able to deliver, then you can say, yes, next time I can do 10% more. Happens with all of us. And the second is, when I deliver, everybody else in the room, the other countries, have the trust that I will deliver. This virtuous cycle of trust and confidence could be created with this kind of architecture. The second point I want to leave you with is the very professional management of the conference by the French presidency. They pushed us. They were completely transparent in what they did, how they did it, and they kept pushing us. I think each major country, India certainly, China certainly, US certainly, and I'm probably the European Union as well, all of us ended up signing on to this set of architecture, of the architectural framework, which was different from what we had gone ready to accept. There was at least one major difference for which we had to get the Prime Minister's approval, because that was different from the negotiating brief that we had got. And I'm sure that this occurred with every country. So I think the French deserve a lot of credit for managing this conference superbly. So different from the way the Danish presidency managed the Copenhagen conference, which ended up in a disaster. I would now like to spend the last few minutes on what does this mean for India. I had spoken of the INDC that we had submitted prior to Paris. That INDC has a number of pledges that we have made, but let me focus on 3 of them. There are more, but let me focus on 3. The first, as I said, was that we pledged that the carbon intensity of our economy, and carbon intensity is greenhouse gas emissions divided by GDP, would be 33% to 35% less in 2030 than it was in 2005. We had also made another pledge. In fact, we had made it at Copenhagen. We didn't need to, but it was a voluntary pledge made by Prime Minister Manmohan Singh that in 2020, this carbon intensity would be 20 to 25% less than it was in 2005. We seem to be on track to reach that goal, but we will just reach it. Our carbon intensity in 2020 will be 21-22% less than what it was in 2030. So there is a good chance that we will meet this goal as well, but it would mean two or three major things. It would certainly mean that energy efficiency increases are much, much more aggressive than they have been till now. In particular, the modeling shows energy efficiency of buildings has to increase by 20 to 40% in order for this goal to be met. The second is renewables. Now, we have also made another pledge, which is that at least 40% of the installed capacity, not generation, of the installed capacity in 2030 would be non-fossil fuel. Non-fossil fuels means renewables, it also means hydro, it also means nuclear. But given the kinds of challenges that we have about hydro, there isn't very much space. About nuclear, which is the timelines that it will take to build, the vast bulk of this 40% will have to come from renewables. Now, in 2030, the estimation is that our installed capacity would be somewhere in the 700 to 800 gigawatt range, which means that the amount of non-fossil fuel installed capacity will be 280 to 320 gigawatts, say 300 gigawatts. Of that 300 gigawatts, possibly something of the order of 60 to 70 gigawatts will come from hydro and nuclear. That means about 230 or 240 will have to be from renewables. Currently, we have something of the order of about 30, 32 gigawatts. We have also made a promise, the government has made a promise that we will add, that our renewable capacity will go up to 175 gigawatts by 2022. Now, so it seems if we will do 175 in 2022 or even in 2023 or 24, reaching 230 by 2030 should not be a problem. But there is a huge catch in between these two. And that has to do with the fact that once the amount of renewable energy in our grid is more than, say, 15%, and at the levels that we are talking about, the amount that it would be certainly in that range. It would probably be in the 15-20%. You need to balance it. What does that mean? That when the sun stops shining and the wind stops blowing, how do you and I get electricity? It will either come from renewable energy, or from fossil fuels. In other words, we will have set up a coal power plant or a gas plant, which will only work when the sun is not shining and the wind is not blowing. Think of its cost. The cost of electricity from such a plant will be very high. Or you have something, some storage of some kind. Hydro pumped storage is the easiest, in which you have a hydro station which has got two reservoirs at two levels. When you've got excess electricity from renewables, you use it to pump the water from the lower reservoir to the higher reservoir. And when you need it, for example, in the evening, water flows from the upper reservoir to the lower reservoirs, turning turbines and producing electricity. So it's, you have stored the renewable energy. Battery storage is yet another megawatt level battery storage. But it's a technology which isn't here. So the renewable energy price that we will have to look for in 2030 will have to be a price which is the price of renewables, which is what we talked about, coming down from 18 rupees to 4 rupees 30, or in the case of wind to 3 rupees. It is that price plus the price of the balancing electricity. So it's the price of a coal power station which works for only the time when the other, when this is not available, or for the cost of pumped storage, or the cost of batteries. And you have to merge the two to find out what is the true cost of renewables. This is a challenge we will have to overcome before somewhere around 2025 in order to meet this goal in 2030. In other words, it's a doable goal, but it requires major effort. I believe we will need to have major technological efforts to have more efficient, less costly renewable energy in the first place, and then an integration system in the grid, and then a balancing system on the other side. The Electricity Act amendment that's before Parliament already proposes to create a balancing market. But I don't know when that amendment will be passed. But at least we have made the first steps. The third major INDC pledge that we made was that the carbon dioxide sequestration that we do will go up to 2.5 billion tons per year from the current 1 billion tons. This is again a challenge. And it's a challenge because there is no land available. Where will you plant these? So the challenge is densification of the current forest cover. Now, the, if I may call it technologies, what the forest people call their working plans for planting on cleared areas is very well established. We know how to do it. There is a loss, we know how much is the loss. How it is to be added on, we know how to do it. But densification is a technology which is not very well known. How do you do it? When do you do it? What is the distance you should keep? What kinds of plant mixtures can you do? So that's one part. The second part of this is that what are the kinds of business models? Will it all be done through the Forest Department? The government recently put out a policy in which there was a public-private partnership, but that was for the paper industry that they can withdraw, which has attracted a huge degree of public furore. Again, the short point is we do not have a business model which can help us deliver this today. Again, on paper it can be done. On paper we can go up to 4 billion tons of CO2 savings every year from the land that is currently in the control of the Forest Department. And that's why 2.5 billion seemed a reasonable goal. Nevertheless, the technology and the business models are yet to be put out. So what I would like to end with is to highlight the fact that we have a good chance of achieving the pledges we have made. But it would mean that we will have to get money at lower costs. You know, today if you go to the market and borrow, it costs 13%. In the developed countries, money is available at 3%. But if you bring it to India, because of the dollar rupee fluctuations, you have to buy a hedging. And once you buy hedging, it comes to about the same. So we need to figure out how will we do this. Today, hedges are available on a 3 to 5 year basis, not on a 10 to 15 or 25 year basis. And if you look at the rupee dollar decline, over a 10 year period, it has never been more than 2.5 to 3% a year. If you do it on a 3 year basis, it goes up to 10%, because there are years in which there are huge spikes. But over a 10-year period, it's relatively much more stable. So there are chances that we can help create hedging mechanisms so that the 3% money in developed countries is available in our country at 6 or 7 or 8%, which would still be far less than the 13% at which it is available, which would also mean that the prices at which renewables are available would come down. As I said, we need to work on energy storage and the entire issue of balancing. And third, we need business models. Whether it is in forestry, whether it is in energy efficiency, whether it is in renewables. Because what you're asking people to do is to put in more money upfront. And each one of us has a fixed amount of money in our pockets. If I put more money here, I have less to spend somewhere else. And therefore, business models that will allow a longer term payment, what we today call annuities or EMIs, is useful. So it's not as if these are out of the box ideas. These are ideas that exist. How to move them from the consumer category to the infrastructure category is a challenge that we face. In other words, Paris has had a reasonable chance of addressing the world's climate problems. There is also a reasonable chance that we in India would be able to meet the pledges that we have made. But in doing so, there is a very large number of institutional changes that are required. Whether it is the institutional changes for the reporting, for the transparency, for the reporting and monitoring mechanism. Whether it is the institutional changes for renewables and energy efficiency. Whether it is the institutional changes to enable more forestry. But all of these would require technology, business models, and policy changes for us to be able to put India onto a development path that is a lower carbon growth development path. Thank you very much.
Dr. Mathur, would you care to take a few questions, please?
As many. This is the part I enjoy most.
Now, you can come back here or in answer from there.
Good.
Thanks.
2 points, sir. Reducing the carbon footprint, government should promote cycling and more cycle-friendly towns and cities, which will drastically reduce the number of two-wheeler usage as well as cars usage so that people can commute by cycling, number one. Number two is, for any technology related to reducing global temperature rise, IPR should not be issued. They should not claim intellectual property right, but UNO can give a huge sum as a reward for that particular technology so that all other countries can use the technology at a lower cost to meet the goals.
Okay. I agree with both the things, but I'm going to throw counter questions. Right? I'm going to be the devil's advocate now. Where do you live? Which city do you live? Okay. Why aren't people bicycling more in Thiruvananthapuram? By the way, in Delhi, the total number of people who bicycle is something of the order of 10%, which is far higher than, say, Netherlands. But people cycle because of economic constraints rather than because it's... So I think the major issue here are two. One is weather, but the other also is safety. If you have to have safety, you will have to physically provide a division between the bicyclists and the motorized traffic. People who drive motorized vehicles don't like it. I mean, the greatest example is the bus rapid transport corridor in Delhi, which was killed because car owners like me did not like the fact that buses had a free lane and cyclists had a free lane. So I'll just leave that with you. But on the second one, on the IPRs, let me ask you a question. Over the past many years, there are many technologies that we have used which are lower carbon. Supercritical coal generation, LED bulbs, wind energy, renewable energy. Has IPR been a problem in any of them?
At the time of of D.D. Kosambi, when D.D. Kosambi and
Listen. I think times have changed. Dr. Kosambi's analysis was based on a particular social and economic structure and a technological basis. Implicit in this was two things. One, that a large consumer base is not available, consumer and industrial base is not available. And the second, that the technological basis for using these is also limited. As I said, when we went to Paris, we went with a very different set of experiences. Now, I used to negotiate technology, and IPRs is what was my major negotiating stick. So I agree with you. I mean, this is what I fought all these years for. But I would also like us to be clear about what we are saying. So I look around me in the energy sector and find IPRs have not been a problem. Now, at Kosambi's time, if we didn't get solar cells, maybe it was good, because we would have been stuck with the solar cell technology of the 60s or 70s. But what it does lead me is a larger question, which I'd like to leave with all of you. I mean, you do this day in and day out. How do you deal with technologies that are evolving very fast? Take solar cells. Should we have set up a solar cell plant? We actually did. In the 80s or 90s, the problem is you're stuck with technology. Should we do it now? I was having a discussion with Professor Baldev Raj. If perovskites come in, maybe we'll be a different ballgame. So there is a question in my mind as to how do you decide when is it time to invest in a technology? The second problem that arises is, till a few weeks ago, I was a government officer like all of you. When you procure through a tender, through a L1 basis. How on earth do I procure LED bulbs? They cost much more. Right? But by large scale procurement, we brought down prices. So this is another issue which now, through a very specific set of measures, we were able to do it. But generally speaking, how do you use markets and volumes to bring down prices and build up performance is a question that I leave with you. I think it is a serious issue on which we have not, as a country, paid much attention. So I'm sorry I'm answering your question with a question. But I think that's what the, for me, that's the stimulation of this audience.
Yeah. Sir, I'm Dr. Nandakumar from Kerala Forest Institute. You were talking about the energy use and climate change scenario. Now, when 10% of the people, now if you take the current scenario, when 10% of the people use 50% of the energy, and again 3 billion people are using insignificant quantity of energy at present, the poverty, they are starved for energy. In that scenario, we want to develop. So in the context of climate change and the current Paris negotiation, do you think that there has to be a shift in the focus from developing countries in the name of, if you take it the market driven, if you take market as the thing, climate change, climate resilient technologies or this thing, is it necessary to shift? And we have to rather, instead of begging for the developed nation, can't we go for a market-driven approach where developing nation has to attract the...
Absolutely.
That way, is it not possible?
Absolutely.
Particularly, you were talking about carbon sequestration through intensification of forest areas. Why not go for the other area? Outside forest, the plenty of areas correct, there, correct, vacant correct. Land is there.
Okay. Again, one, I completely agree with you. One of the things that we have learned is that at the end of the day, what we can do and how we do it is very dependent on ourselves. So the way the Paris Agreement has reached it is every country says what it can achieve. So there's no longer a top-down approach. It is every country saying what it can do. This addresses the first issue that you raised. Since a few countries account for the largest amount of energy use and carbon dioxide emissions, it's not fair that everybody has to take the same kind of cut at the same time. And therefore, this difference that you noticed, that the developed countries are doing absolute reductions, we are doing reductions in the intensity of energy use. That's one part. The second is, we have also learned that at the end of the day, we have to get the technologies that make sense for us. I'll go back to the example of LEDs. The LEDs that came into India were developed for different markets, and the main differences were that we needed a LED bulb like any other electronic or electrical equipment that can work between 150 and 280 volts. We needed, because we have a dirty grid, we needed that the grid does not become dirtier. We wanted the PLF to be 0.9 or 9.5 or better. We wanted that the total harmonics are less than 33%. We put this in our specifications. There was an uproar. People said it will increase the cost. But you've seen what it did to the cost. Now, these things were not done by anybody else. The LED technology is a very simple technology. You get an LED chip, you add a driver to it, so all of these things are in the driver. You make changes in the driver. There's a heat sink, and then there is an optical diffuser. That's it. Where did the development of the driver occur? It occurred in the TI, Texas Instruments Center, right here in Bangalore. Everybody uses it now. Chinese manufacturers make it. It is known as the BIS bulb because it is made according to the BIS specifications we have. Now, I can give the same example about our wind machines, which have been tweaked over the years for our wind conditions. The short point in which I'm agreeing with you is that any technology which has to be used at a very large scale in India will have to take into account the realities of our situation.
Anyone from the participants?
Actually, regarding this forest, densification of forest, so it is maybe theoretically, but practically it is very difficult because population and all those things. So why you are not thinking about the coastal water, because algal culture and all those things, because there is still lot of scope and it is totally unexplored. So why government is not giving more emphasis on that type of environment like coastal?
I think it's a great idea. I mean, I must confess, I don't belong to the Forest Service or the Ministry of Environment, but I think it's a great idea. It is an idea that should be explored. It would be very useful. I mean, if you or somebody else who knows more about this can write about it, what I can certainly promise is that it would get a serious hearing, because the Ministry of Environment and the Forest Service is amazingly concerned about this 2.5 billion tons goal that we have made for ourselves.
Actually, I am from Center of Salt and Marine Chemical Research Institute. We have a very strong marine algae group.
let's work together.
When the agreement was made,
on what basis it was made, saying that by some 2020-2030 the energy requirement using non-nuclear or non-fossil types fuel will be used, and then
on what basis it was done? Let me explain this to you, since I was an active participant in it. It started with numbers that came out. All the departments of the government were asked for what the, you know, we in the Bureau of Energy Efficiency were asked what the energy demand will be. And then various departments were asked what the supply projection will be. So they gave these numbers. Then the Planning Commission has got a tool, and I will very openly say it here, it is a tool which I think has huge problems, because the most important thing is that structurally it assumes that the structure of the economy is the same between now and 2050. So these things, numbers were put there and they projected something. When our minister saw them, he said, this is garbage. There is no way that this can happen physically. So there was a Saturday when the minister and officers from many ministries sat together and did a realistic check on what the demand growths could be and what the supplies could be. And it is this, in a sense, black box discussion. I mean, to the best of my knowledge, this has never been published, but I believe that that is the highest quality work I have ever seen being done. It was on the basis of that that these numbers, the numbers that we came up with were different, but then they went to cabinet, you know, there was cabinet secretary headed a meeting, then cabinet took a meeting where the 40% number was finally agreed. So it was a political number which was based on technical inputs.
Could it go wrong?
You know, the technical numbers were 50%. The politicians said 50 is too large. We'll do it at 40. So both the technical and the political feeling was that 40 should be doable. Now, as I said, it is doable, but it depends on whether we can get a balancing market. Otherwise, this much renewables we will not be able to absorb in our grid.
So this was based on some assumption.
Of course, all of these things are based on huge assumptions. Because, you know, we knew, see, first of all, it was very clear that for a variety of reasons, our coal-based generation cannot continue at the rate at which it is continuing. One of the constraints was the availability of coal. Even today, we import, I think 30% of the coal that is used in the country is imported, even today. And I'm sure it's true of all of you, it was true of me. When I went to engineering college, we were told that there is so much coal in the country that it will last for 200 years. And here I am in my own lifetime, in my own professional lifetime, seeing 30% of the coal being imported. It was also very clear that as we import more and more fuel, whether it's coal or petroleum, the impact on the budget will keep on increasing. Consequently, for economic security and environmental security reasons, it is important, irrespective of climate change, to move towards non-fossil fuel generation. So that's the public policy part. The second part was that if you're looking at non-fossil fuels, what are you looking at? And then, as I said, we were looking at nuclear, we were looking at hydro. In hydro, people said, you know, it will be very difficult. We are currently at, I think, 30,000 megawatts, 30 gigawatts of hydro. Crossing 40, 45 is going to be very difficult by 2030. I mean, so there were some very realistic assumptions that were made at that time. So the interesting thing is, these are never written. When you write a paper, it's a lot more optimistic about hydro than the discussions in that room.
Sir, I'm A.K. Bhatt from Department of Atomic Energy. This is with regard to point number 3 in the pledge. I see a scope that at least this one, densification of the forests, because we are in the field of exploration, and many a times we see that the MOEF rules are very stringent, and to obtain the permissions for carrying out our exploration.
And you can imagine they'll become even more stringent.
It's very difficult. But on the paper or on the maps or on the this thing, the reserve forest, protected forest, such forest, this forest, but actually they do not appear on the field.
There are no trees there.
On the field. So there is a scope for densification and a continuous monitoring by MOEF that what is there on the paper should really exist on ground.
So you're absolutely right. I mean, one of the discussions that this one of the processes that this discussion has engendered is that the minister started getting into more and more detail, the Minister of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. And then he started saying, show me pictures. So now they are getting a system in place in which each forest area will be digitally photographed, and that would be available so that you can see what is there. The second thing is, the minister was very concerned about the very high mortality of plantations. Because, you know, when you're doing a forest, you can't water every plant. So there's natural mortality. So then he started thinking of the kinds of costs that would be involved if you do drip irrigation. So what I'm glad is that this process helped in both the minister and the forest department to start looking at new ways to both monitor and push the forestation.
Densification of forest. Actually, I'm from Indian Bureau of Mines. What happened? There is a classification of forest land, non-forest land. Majority of the mining operation takes place in non-forest land, and whenever any forest land operation takes place, and especially after 2011, Supreme Court ordered to stop all the mining operation which is are carrying out in forest area. Whenever any forest land to be put in operation, so what happened when they giving the before the clearance, they have to go through stage 1 clearance, stage 2 clearance.
Right.
It involves a lot of guidelines as per the MOEF in continuation with Mr. But that per hectare of land when they want to put for mining operation, so they have to give the compensatory land, compensatory cost, and protection of fencing, so many other costs involved. For each hectare, so many lakhs they have to spend.
Pay.
Especially for cost of compensatory afforestation, they pay minimum 1.5 to 2 lakhs per hectare of land.
Correct.
And along with that, fencing cost involves goes to 5 to 6 lakhs per hectare. In addition to that, NPV value goes 5.7 lakhs to 9.5 lakhs per hectare.
Right.
Excluding cost of compensatory afforestation.
Right.
All these costs are involved. There is no any problem in densification. Densification, they have all experts from MOEF.
So,
especially I pass through different states of our mining operation like Odisha, Jharkhand.
Now I'm in looking up to Karnataka, and but I never see any forest land in Karnataka like what I saw in Odisha and Jharkhand. We can see real dense forest in Jharkhand and Odisha. Whereas in Karnataka, simply they say forest land, but absolutely there is no any forest growth, except only we can see only the stones or every forest shrubs and bushes, that's all. There is no any important plants. But though they give so much compensatory afforestation, land, compensatory additional
money.
Land they have to give, but they are all very unimportant plants they just planted. But they don't give any long-term, this one, a good plantation where it can grow for a long period and it helps to have a dense afforestation.
Yeah. But you know the history of this.
Yes.
All this money goes into the camper fund.
Is not difficult.
Yeah.
It is,
it is
like yesterday,
what I see, we have heard that attitudes, how the MOEF taking the attitudes, or the government takes the attitudes in order to improve the forestation, in order to reduce all this.
I am of the view that attitudes are determined by what is available. The problem with the Ministry of Environment and the Forest Department is that there is no institutional mechanisms for making this happen. The CAMPA money went into a fund. That fund had risen to 20,000 crores. It was parked in a bank account. The checkbook to that was in the desk of the Secretary Environment. But because of various reasons, because of legal challenges, that money could not be used. Now that money is being provided to states to do exactly the kind of thing that you did. This was this whole issue of how will the money be divided among states and all that kind of stuff. There is a problem of, does the forest departments, state forest departments, have adequate capacity to do it? Because not so much compensatory afforestation has to be done that it needs a huge amount of manpower, supervision, and therefore, you know, when you've got lots of people doing lots of things, you need very clear technical guidance. Now, the Forest Department is very good as far as technical guidance for new areas are concerned, but densification is something for which we don't have it. So, my short point is that we need to have those kinds of guidelines, we need to have that kind of capacity, and we need to have that kind of a institutional model through which it can be done. But the point that you're saying is absolutely right. I think the opportunity is there.
They've got all their technology, sir, and there's nothing short in their technology to implement densification, because that's why the lessees who undertake mining operation, the forest land, without paying all this compensatory land cost,
So they have the money.
Yeah, yes.
That's all they have.
No, there's nothing short.
there is technology. It is not available. Technology is there for densification, for improving the degraded forest. Lot of technologies are there. It is not that the problem is the institutional mechanism which is weak.
Correct.
We require is that we require manpower professionally qualified to implement it. Efficiency, all these things are there.
And if you are going to depend on taking 11 or 15 forest officers a year to do it, it can't be done.
If you see in Orissa, that's what I said, Orissa, Jharkhand, the real reserve forest can be seen. It will be so dense,
you will find difficult to enter the area. Mm-hmm. It will be so dangerous to enter the area.
Okay. Yeah. Adding to the discussion, see, in fact, we are talking about the agroforestry. Why can't we talk about even the horticulture sector? In fact, the present generation where mangoes are cultivated, there is hardly 40 plants in an acre. And now there are technologies where there is very high density planting. In fact, in Brazil, one of the farmers has planted 900 plants in an acre. So that kind of technologies are already available. In fact, TNAU has gone up to 600 plants. So in fact, even in the agriculture scenario, this could be addressed. And it not only does the carbon sequestration
increase,
it also increases food security.
Yeah, absolutely.
So and so in additional incomes also come. So this could be one of the probable suggestions that you could give to the ministry, where the technologies are already available. Mango, it has been proven. Cashew, it has been proven. There are many other orchard plants where we can go for very high density planting.
Okay. Gopi.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure to hear you. I have a question. This is largely coming after reading a recent article that appeared in the Foreign Affairs. It appears that the global focus is on warming. It's gratifying to know that we have an agreement after Paris, but this fixation on temperature target provides a very long luxury, because it provides a long time horizon for planning, which may delay the policy that we would like to be in place. So the article by Ramanathan says that there is a much more serious problem called dimming, which is produced by aerosols. So I would like to know whether there is a realization in the government and the negotiators that this is a more serious problem than even warming, because it has an immediate impact, unlike the uncertain impact that is projected by temperature rises.
You know, the negotiations take their scientific cue from the IPCC reports. The IPCC reports have discussed aerosols. They have discussed things, other things that Ramanathan speaks of, such as black soot. The challenge, of course, is how are these scientific findings becoming part of the negotiation process? So the very technical answer to this is that there is a technical annex of gases that are considered when you are doing this. The challenge with things like aerosols and black soot is the short residence times. Now, it's a challenge, it's an opportunity, because if India is able to do those very soon, you get a huge bang for the buck. But is it something that would lead to a longer term impact as we were looking at? So this is at the edge of science and politics. And as all such things, it really depends on the kinds of efforts that individuals make and the kinds of efforts that the political discussion takes, whether they are included or not. So, you know, for example, black soot is something which people have been talking for a long time, hasn't come into the list as yet. Aerosols is also something people have talked about, but as I said, the issue of the short term versus long term, whenever this is brought up, there's a discussion on this and it dies.
Yes.
I've been invited by my wife, Niharika, who's sitting there. Okay. My question is, with oil prices going down significantly, probably about 70%, 60 to 70%, how easy it is for you to encourage alternate fuel, alternate energy sources?
Sure. You know, so what we have done in India, which most countries have not done, is that as the prices have reduced, we have kept on increasing the tax on fuel. So
you and I as consumers see a much smaller decline than what has actually happened. But very few countries have done this. If we don't do this, the pressure on consumers will disappear. Now, the reason we have done it is not climate change. I mean, I'll be very frank, it's about balancing the budget. That's why Mr. Jaitley does it. Yeah. And he sees this as a very easy source. We are used to petrol at whatever, 70 rupees or 75 rupees a liter. And we feel very happy if from 75 it goes to 69. But on the other hand, he is mopping up 30 rupees more. But that is why in India, this process will continue. We make it a point to, at every forum, particularly the G20, to point out that if all countries don't do it, we will not be able to meet our climate targets.
And what else, sir? Are there carbon taxes and those sort of things with the Europeans and others?
So we have a carbon tax. You know, we started off with a tax of 50 rupees per ton of coal, went up to 100, went up to 200, and in this budget went up to 400 rupees per ton of coal. So that's all that money goes into something called the National Clean Energy Fund. So, you know, what is it used for? Things like, we've got a huge amount of solar and wind energy generation occurring in Western Rajasthan and Gujarat. All of this comes as load. The load is Delhi. You have to build a new transmission line, but it operates 30% of the time. So the price of carrying every electron on this is very high. So NCEF, the National Clean Energy Fund, provides a viability gap funding, a one-type funding, so that over its lifetime, the cost that it will charge for moving an electron of renewable energy is the same as from a plant which operates a 70% plant load factor. So then similarly for rural solar systems, also there's a viability gap funding and so on. So I think the tools that we have are in the right direction. We could have more, that's a separate issue.
My name is Narayanan. Firstly, I would like to, I'm sure I echo a lot of people's views here, that I must thank you for an absolutely brilliant demystification of the climate conference in Paris. We all stand very much enlightened now. I have it's a technical query, since there's a lot of forest related knowledge here, perhaps somebody might be able to clarify this. Secondly, I have a comment to make if I have your permission. First is on the carbon sequestration by the forest cover and so on. I've been looking for information on, is there an efficiency issue in the kind of forest, in the kind of plants which absorb carbon better?
Sure.
Because except for some vague references about, there are some plants which have got some kind of a leaf pattern which seeks...
And the rate of absorption as well, both.
Yes,
of those.
But I have not been able to quite absorb. For example, yes, if I ask a question, does only the tree, the branches, the leaf cover matter, or does the trunk size matter? Do creepers have the same efficiency as trees? I just don't find this kind of information, because there is something very important that can be done. For example, in a whole lot of urban settings, you can bring in a whole lot of rooftop foliage as a mandatory requirement. Right. Now, today we have rainwater harvesting as a mandatory requirement. I don't see why carbon sequestration cannot be a mandatory requirement in an urban setting. But there isn't enough data to say what is more efficient.
Yeah.
This is where maybe some of the people with knowledge in forestry might be able to throw some light. If I may continue, the second is a short comment on the last point you made about the solar cell, you know, how to set up a manufacturing
when,
and so on.
How? Yeah.
The photovoltaic and so on.
Mm.
I just want to share a little bit of history. As you can see, I joined the R&D system in India in 52 years back. And about 50 years back, as a young electronics engineer in a semiconductor laboratory, my task was to set up some instrumentation and measure the IV characteristics and efficiency of the solar cell, which was developed indigenously. And I was very, very happy to report with my instrumentation that the silicon polycrystalline silicon solar cell, which my lab made, had registered an efficiency of something like 5% or something.
Mm-hmm.
It is just 18 years after the Bell Labs invention. At that time, the global was around 9 to 10%. Today we have moved to 35%, whatever. But it never translated into an industry.
Right, right.
And some of you might know, some of you might not, the indigenously made photovoltaic cell flew in the, as a piggyback payload in one of the ISRO platforms for test purposes. That is a level which had been reached in 1971. Today we have no polycrystalline, monocrystalline, thin film solar cell manufacturing in the country. Whatever existed about 6, 7 years back has now been shut down. Now, this is clearly a policy failure, but I want to add, there is a little syndrome, there is something called the down the up staircase syndrome. There is a staircase which is marked up, but everybody is coming down. This is what happened in silicon. As you probably know, the silicon solar cell, mostly made on bulk silicon, bulk junctions, has really no great lithography technology problem. We are really talking about very large size junctions. The microelectronics, on the other hand, is hugely limited by the lithography and the fineness of the junction that you can make. We jumped into that bandwagon. The entire silicon focus shifted to microelectronics. We missed that bus and missed this bus too. We neither made solar cell nor made microelectronics, but we had a department of electronics giving directions as to who is not to do what. Now, having lived through this syndrome for 50 years, I want to tell you, those of you who are in the cycle now, please see if you are repeating this tragedy again. And I am very, very sure that the status in which we find ourselves in the silicon solar cell or for that matter even gallium arsenide, is of our own doing. It was clearly a case of a policy failure. So, and I would very much appreciate someone enlightening me on that carbon sequestration.
So the only point that I'd leave you with is the last point. There was a huge amount of investment made in solar cell manufacturing in this country. And I think 3 years ago, 4 years ago, there we were manufacturing, if I'm not wrong, something of the order of cells, of something of the order of 15 megawatts worth of capacity every year. You're right that most of it is now non-functional. And the reason it's non-functional is for economic reasons. They got a particular technology. Meanwhile, in the rest of the world, new, more efficient technologies came, which provide electricity at a lower cost. That's the question that I was asking. How do you determine when do I invest in a technology? Do I invest in a technology only if I have the R&D backup that I can keep on ratcheting it up periodically? Otherwise, I put in an investment and I am stuck. And like some very, very well-known names, including in this town, I have a huge, beautiful factory and nobody is willing to buy my products. Yeah, 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 of course, of course. It's everything. So, yeah. So the point is, as a country, we have not done it in anything. We have been very poor on the technology curve.
I think we have. Well, two gentlemen showed their hands there. Please. And would you please make your questions short?
Yes, sir. Sir, my name is Anant. I just have one question regarding the thermal power plants. As you had mentioned that it is still bulk of the power is being produced through them, and as we go later by 2020, still 60% of the power, I think, will be produced by thermal power plants.
Like 60% of capacity.
Capacity, yeah.
Generation maybe actually
Yes,
more.
Sir. Yeah. National Clean Energy Fund, like what we have, this fund, which is being used currently for building a separate infrastructure for the transmission lines, apart from the infrastructure. Sir, is there any plan for taking into account the plant load factor of these thermal power plants, which is not more than 70%, I guess, currently, for the best of the plants? As they age older, the efficiency reduces. And is there any trade-off between the cost of importing coal as well as the obsolete value? Because I think at some point in time, we had to take into account the cost of the operation of these obsolete thermal power plants.
So it's a question that is being debated right now. The new chairman of NTPC makes a point that we should buy electricity from the most efficient plants. But the problem is that the less efficient plants were made at a time when the capital cost was cheaper. And therefore, the price at which I get electricity is less than the price at which I get electricity from the more efficient plants. So there is a policy issue there in how the merit order would be developed. It's an issue under discussion. I don't even know if there's a right answer.
Hello. Yes. No. I think he wanted to... Well, make it quick because we have a lady there. And that will be the, please.
Regarding the elements of smart cities, transit-oriented development models coming up in Delhi, and vertical farming, as all these elements as in the model of urban planning, how climate resilient are they?
I have no idea. It's an important issue because clearly urban energy use is going to be a major, you know, managing urban energy use is going to be a major driver of how we meet our pledge. That's very clear. But on the specifics of these issues, it's not an area where I have personal knowledge.
I'd like to bring in another point, which is similar to what Dr. Narayanan made. And that is, for example, one can quote many examples. We're talking about a scrappage policy for motor vehicles, supposedly to improve air quality.
Yeah.
And article appeared more than 20 years ago in Science, which showed that repair and use of clean fuel was more than an order of magnitude better per $1 billion spent than any scrappage policy. Are we going to be driven by the terms of debate that are aired in the media, sometimes the paid media, by, in this case, the automobile industry, or are we going to do something slightly different? Now, this is just an example of what can be done. In Bangalore, people don't realize that if you put in fuel in Whitefield, which is considered part of Bangalore, you're using much lower quality fuel, two or three tanks full and your catalytic converter is dead. Completely dead. And you can never revive it unless you replace it. And I don't know anyone in India who replaces catalytic converters. Similarly, people bypass exhaust gas recirculation systems because that affects their fuel consumption or the power output, etc. So there's no attempt, and if you have a system of checking every 6 months or even every 6 days, it's just a matter of just putting a pipe back or reconnecting a couple of wires. Now, the reason that I'm bringing this up is that these are the kinds of relatively low-cost things that can be done to improve CO2 emissions or reduction of other pollutants, etc., which we don't want to acknowledge because they don't attract the kind of fanciful schemes that are useful for the television screens.
Okay, again, I will say watch this space. This, you know, the scrappage policy is something that we have just started working on. But based on my BEE experience, there is an issue that we looked at, which was when do you focus much more on the first, on the quality of the first product, that you have got a much higher energy efficiency, and when do you focus on maintaining that efficiency during operation? By nature, this is not an analysis, but more anecdotal. The larger the number of units are that you need to make sure that they are performing well, the larger is the implementation cost. The more inspectors you will have, the more corruption you will have. So therefore, the first rule, this is my rules, it's not anybody else's rules. First rule, limit O&M efficiency programs to one sectors where there is a relatively fewer number of players, and more importantly, where there is a reputational risk associated with them. So if you go and put an advertisement in the newspaper, this guy did not meet the norms, it hurts him. In places where you need this kind of an impact, which where, for example, numbers are very large, you know, for example, I don't keep my car well. And when I go to get it tested, either I pay the fellow something and he fiddles something and says, you are now okay. Or, as you said, I bypass various systems. Now, even if I'm caught, okay, there'll be a penalty, I'll pay the penalty. If you put my name in the newspaper, one, you'll have to put 1 million names in the newspaper. That's a bit much. But I personally don't have a great reputational risk. On the other hand, if we are talking of, say you are saying that the Tata power plant is not meeting its norms, that is serious for them. These are the kinds of rules of thumb that I think could guide us. But as I said, this is my experience on the scrappage. As I said, watch this space. We will work on this.
Mrs. Nolan.
Yes. That's the last question.
My name is Dr. Revathi Narayanan. Thank you, Dr. Mathur. That was absolutely brilliant.
My question is, in the, you know, any science has a social setting, and you mentioned some of it, and that also implies behavior change in a very, 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 you know, across the board.
Yeah.
So, some thoughts on the current climate of, you know, privatization, maximization of profit, a very consumerist lifestyle, using up more and more resources. What is the kind of public education that has to happen? And my sense is this has to happen much sooner than 2020.
We'll be on it now.
So is there anything happening, any thoughts in government circles? What would you, could you enlighten us?
Unfortunately, this is a incomplete answer. The first point that you've made, I couldn't agree with you more. I think, you know, we can do everything, but if you and I don't change our behavior at the end of the day, you know, the question that I often ask, is this glass half full or half empty? Well, I should actually be saying the glass is too big for the job that it's supposed to do. So similarly, I can have the most efficient car, but if I have a huge SUV, so that's the kind of consumer behavior we want to change. We did not think of this at the time when we introduced the star labeling program, but now consumer behavior, you know, journals have started analyzing that program to see how it has impacted consumer behavior. So clearly information is important, and clearly credibility of the information is important. At least that's what people were writing about our program. And what impact did it have? Over a 6-year period, the average refrigerator that is sold in India is 30% more efficient than it was in 2000. This is between 2007 and 2013. And the average air conditioner was 25% better. So you and I did make a choice when we went in and bought. We did make a choice. It did change our behavior. But we did not think of it in consumer terms at the time when we did it. There is a lot of learning that came out. You know, for example, the learning that you and I will invest in something which is more expensive if I can get a payback in 3 to 5 years. How do you use it for, therefore, for designing programs? I don't know. I very recently changed jobs and have now moved to an NGO, Terry, and I'm looking for people who would help develop a program on behavioral change. And to my great surprise, there is nobody available in India who I can beg or poach.
Before I call upon Dr. Shaivar Chakraborty to propose the vote of thanks, I would personally tell you, Ajay, it is a magnificent lecture, and the discussions and the way you handled the questions and answers, they really enriched the whole thing, and it's absolutely great. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Dr. Mathur has been a leader both in thought and action in every field of energy and climate change in this country. In the last decade and a half, if we have made a lot of progress in these fields, it's due to the leadership and the great policymaking skills of Dr. Mathur. He's given us a brilliant and lucid exposition on a variety of matters in a short 1-hour talk. He's covered the mechanics of climate treaties and the negotiation process, the architecture of treaties, what works, what doesn't work, what are the challenges, the unique set of challenges that India faces, and a variety of, and has shared his rich experience in the policymaking successes and failures that India has seen. He's left us with a ringside view of what the negotiations in Paris were all about. Why do we hope that this treaty might have a glimmer of success? Why is it that a treaty which has, in some sense, a soft legal basis might still be successful because it's based on voluntary contributions, which people might hold each other to, and that might actually make the treaty more successful in the long run. And finally, he has left us with a rich understanding of what the challenges mean for India. What do India's intended nationally determined contributions actually mean in terms of the technological and the policy challenges, and to what extent we can actually hope that we would be successful. I think some of us will leave this room with at least a glimmer of hope that both India and the world is on the right direction, even though we have a lot more to do and a lot more challenges to face. And for the scientists in the audience, I believe a lot of you have been inspired to work on problems that will answer some of the challenges that Dr. Mathur has written for us. I thank Dr. Mathur and all of you for a very stimulating evening. Thank you.